Hello, everyone. My name is Akshat Rathee, and I wanted to welcome all of you to this episode where we're going to be discussing some really cool stuff with Valorant. And we have some of the best people you can ever think of on this. We have players, we have the guys who are from the publishers, we have team owners, we have content creators, and all of us are just going to be together exploring this beautiful world of Valorant.
Please tell me you have the package.
I would if somebody was a little less aggressive. Hey, stop! I said stop! Oh, that's how you wanna play it.
Alright, I'm going in.
What about the hostile?
I wouldn't worry about her.
Are you certain?
100!
I got this.
Mianese Ojana?
Hey, Control, so about the package...
Oh my God, Sukamal, that was so awesome. This is so beautiful. Tell us this journey of Valorant, and where did it come, and how long did this take to go ahead and manifest?
Yeah, I think Luciano is in a much better position to answer this, because he is a guy who has been, like, you know, he's the mouthpiece for Valorant for our region. So I think I'll let him take this question. And I can already see the excitement and smile on his face, because he's raring to talk about Valorant. And of course, he's going to talk about his own journey as well. But I think he's the best mouthpiece for Valorant for our audience.
Wow, thanks, Sukamal. Putting me under the spotlight immediately, you know, from the get-go. Great. Where did Valorant come from, or when did Valorant start is a question that I personally do not know. I know that it's been in the making within Riot Games for quite some time. It's been in development for quite some time. When exactly, I do not know. I only joined Riot Games over a year ago. So I knew from when I joined that there's going to be an S to Riot Games, and I knew that there was going to, you know, we're going to have a game that comes out. We didn't know that it was called Valorant, actually, up till 4 months before Alpha comes out. So we had like code names internally. But what is it, and how good is it? It is a 5v5 tactical shooter with style, with agents that have abilities. So it does have a twist to your traditional tactical shooters. It is a stylish game. How good is it? I'll leave that to the players to decide. I personally am in love with the game, so I'm playing it religiously. What makes it special? I think what makes it special is our team. You know, the guys and you know, the gentlemen and the ladies that are working behind the Valorant as a whole. I think every single one of them brings a set of expertise to the table. They've put a lot of hard work and a lot of effort in making sure that we have a nice final polished game that will appeal to our players. I'm not sure if Sukamal mentioned this earlier, but one thing that I've learned with Riot Games, and I think this was one of the best experiences I've had, is everything we do is player comes first. It's all about player experience. And, you know, whether we really take care of the game, release a patch every Wednesday, listen to them, fix this. I mean, yesterday alone, if you looked at our Twitter channel, no matter what we say, people are, you know, replying with ranked, when is ranked, everyone wants ranked. So eventually we had to just push rank. I can see Ankit smiling. I'm sure that if I scroll somewhere on Twitter, I can see you, one of the people who will say ranked. But so it's always players first. And that player experience or players mentality reflects in when the game was being developed as well. You know, we had some of the best of the best within the industry, making sure that everything we do is for a good experience, whether it's having the 128 tick server, whether it's making sure that you know, at launch we're going to be able to have 70% of the world at you know, at 70 ping or 40 ping or 50 ping. The anti-cheat program itself, it's very rare to find games that put that entire anti-cheat program at the forefront or at the beginning of creating a game. So we started with Vanguard while developing Valorant. They both came together at the same time. So putting all that love and all these attention to details to develop a game with some of the best experts in the industry spells recipe for success.
Just to continue with what Luciano said, so anybody who's worked with Riot since the past, let's say that 3 to 4 years, always knew that it was coming, right? So it has been in R&D for quite some time, and all of us experienced it at some stage of the game's development, right? So I'm sure that when Nimish was there, it was called Project A, so that's the internal code name for it. So we all play tested it. I mean, whenever we go to headquarters, we were given a sneak peek, and every time we go there, we see development of the game, literal development, right? From the time we saw it last, maybe 6 months back, so to the stage that it was in, it was becoming more and more impressive. We always knew it was coming. And to be honest, like Luciano mentioned, we did not, even internally to a lot of teams, we are not sure when it's going to drop, right? We knew that it was going to be 2020, but exact date, time, how the schedule was, it was a very under wraps project. And even a name reveal was as a need to know basis. It was a super secret project, right? So it was an open secret, but nobody knew. Everybody knew it's about its existence, but nobody knew when it's going to come out, how is it going to look like, and what is the product that's actually going to drop on the players. What are they going to experience? So that's something which was just a very interesting journey for all of us, because we knew that it was coming, but had no details. Just we were players first, right? So we just looked at it as a player first, and later, of course, as a publisher as well, from our different teams and different regions, we all had to wrap our heads ourselves as well. But we were equally excited just as players to see that, hey, we want to see and play with our fan base and play with them as players and not as a publisher. And so it was a super exciting journey for us, especially the last 3-4 months when we finally knew that it was coming, it was happening, and we're going to finally play with our players. And that has been a terrific journey for us.
Oh, got it. I actually, there's so much information that we've just been given by both of you, and love to go ahead and deep dive into this. First, actually, let's just waterfall this down. I wanted to go ahead and ask you, one of the things that excites someone like me, and every player is different, is there is actually some kind of a backstory, right? I grew up at a time where every game had a story, every game had a reason, every game had a journey. And to me, this entire world of Valorant made sense, because, you know, where did the Radiant come from? How did the Radiant come? What's this something that has happened across this? And there is that looks like Morocco, India, Syria, Pakistan-ish. There's this so much backstory and lore. To me, that matters a lot for me to even pick up the game. Does that matter to you, someone like a Xyaa, who's, you've played Overwatch and you've looked at that Overwatch beautiful universe that has been stitched together? Or does it not matter to someone like you, Ankit, which is, we started off with Counter-Strike. There is no really story to Counter-Strike, right? Two different people, which is there. And then even someone other on this, for example, Nimish, you've loved games like Street Fighter and that lore that is there. So how does this entire thing work for different views? Xyaa, you want to go first?
So for me, lore, it does matter, but it doesn't matter as much as the gameplay, the whole 5v5 aspect. I do enjoy looking looking up the backstories of all the different characters and seeing where they came from and why they have the abilities that they have. It is definitely interesting, but yeah, as long as the gameplay is fun for me, it doesn't really matter too much. It's like a like, you know, the nerdy way of like knowing the backstory and everything. Yeah, it's cool. It's nice. But yeah, it doesn't matter to me as much.
And just to go ahead and deep dive just on that question, what's your favorite characters? Which ones do you like playing? Which ones did you pick up first?
I first of all picked Omen, but then I heard that Phoenix is really good as like, he's like, you know, the solo kind of fragger. Like he has his flash and everything, so he can just go in and flash and then get kills. So I kind of like that. I am not really big with strategies and stuff. I just like fragging. So that's why I picked him up and then I loved him. So yeah, and then I played him for quite a while and now I'm back to Omen because I saw some videos of like really cool teleportation tricks and stuff. So yeah, I'm trying that out now.
Ankit, would you like to go ahead and talk about this? Like, I know you're this, like, if I have to go ahead and say, you are probably the face of Counter-Strike from India, right? I think there are more fans for Ankit Panth who keep on stopping him while walking on the street to take selfies with him. And I'm going from one part of a tournament to another part of the tournament takes about 2 hours if you walk with you. So with that fame comes that responsibility of having been through this early journey of Counter-Strike. When you picked up this game, what super excited you? And give us some examples.
So as you said, the backstory, yes, it really matters to me. I really enjoy, but earlier, you know, there was, I didn't know Akshat Rathee, or I didn't know Riot Games or Sukamal, because there was no one to, you know, connect us so that I could talk what was the backstory behind Valorant. But now I can, because they are in front of me. So back then in Counter-Strike, I made my own story that I am the good cop, these guys on the server are the bad cops, and I have to destroy them, save my country. So that's what I did, and I started playing like a chore police kind of a thing, that, you know, I am a cop and I have these are guys, you know, coming to steal from my home, and I have to stop them. They are going to plant the bomb, I'm going to defuse the bomb. So those were the things which I made up in my head, and then I started playing. And you know, coming to Valorant, this is the first game, you know, that I've played, and I felt that, you know, this game is stylish. Like the dialogues these characters say, it actually feels like it gives me goosebumps. Like, oh man, this is it, man! I got a kill, 3 kills, let's go. So all these things are kind of very motivating when you play Valorant. And the best part is the 128 tick rate servers. Now when it was in beta, we played on 170 ping, and sometimes when we got good servers, we played on 150. Lucky days, we played on 120, and we were able to, you know, have good matches, perform better in front of those European players also. So when it comes to Counter-Strike, 64 tick rate servers kind of, you know, don't give us that edge. We have to, we need 120 tick rate servers. We need, you know, Indian servers specifically, but we don't have that in Counter-Strike. But luckily now, I've read a lot of articles from Riot Games and a lot of news media houses that there is this hope of Indian servers coming, and that is what, you know, all the Indian players are waiting for. The moment this news is announced, I'm very sure that, you know, you will see a huge spike, because people are just waiting. You have given them 128 tick rate servers. Riot listens to the community. They have a very strong emotional connect like I have with my fans, and this is what, you know, connects me to Riot Games also.
So Kumal, actually, he's asked you and put you on the spot. A little separately. So would you like to go ahead and officially ask you this. Tell us a little more about that little announcement that you did. Maybe some people missed it out. Would you like to go ahead and say it again?
Yeah, absolutely. I'm like, we are fully committed now. I'm like, we've put our names and like, you know, and our words on like on print as well. And so this is a huge commitment from our side. And we're definitely going to have a proper roadmap on how we're going to be servicing the region, right? So from a region perspective, we are known as MENAI, which is Middle East, North Africa, and the Indian subcontinent, right? So it's not just India for us, but it's also all the neighboring countries of Pakistan, Sri Lanka, Bangladesh, Bhutan, Nepal, and Maldives. And the idea is to like, how do we service this region, which has definitely a huge potential in terms of the genre as well as the platform, but was never fully published or was never fully serviced by, let's say, by us, right? So that's the reason why we say, like, let's, for this game, I think there's a huge potential that we should definitely not overlook, and let's make those commitments, right? And that's the reason why we put the word out that we will be supporting it, not just with the 128 tick servers, et cetera, but also with a local service, right? And that is coming up later this year. And it's going to be based out of Dubai. touch wood, and we will be able to bring the consistency in the service across the whole region, right? So we will be servicing players from both MENA as well as the Indian subcontinent from that service. And from our, like say, from our calculations, it is going to be, it's going to make everybody very happy, right? And that is the service that we definitely want to like bring to the region here. And that's just a start, right? We are just getting started. And after that, we do want to bring in all the publishing, like the Zing Bang and all the other things that come along with, let's say, an infrastructure service, which also means a lot of publishing in terms of marketing, in terms of making sure that we are delivering the right message to our player base, giving them the right experiences, and also unlocking a lot of events and excitement, which make them keep like stay interested in the game for a long term, right? So for Riot, we don't look at games from a month-to-month perspective, but we look at games from, let's say, from a decade perspective. What do we want to see this region doing for, like, you know, what do we see this region in the next 10 years? So from the perspective, the whole MENA region for us is very critical, because this is where I believe our hypothesis is like that next growth of, like, you know, our games is going to be delivered from this region, both in terms of the mobile platform as well as the PC platform. And this is where we are making those investments and commitment, right? And so I can't, like, you know, personally, I can't wait to get this kickstarted for the next 10 years at least.
Nimish, I have a question for you. You know, you've just announced something like Fnatic Rising, and there's a different version of that in different parts of the world. And you're building a very custom community-led program, which is called Fnatic Rising. How does Valorant work for you? And as first as a player, second as a community head, and third as a team manager, to go ahead and build out this whole ecosystem, especially if you can go ahead and talk about what your view of the game is.
Well, I was obviously fortunate enough to actually play this game when I was at Riot, and it was called Project X at that point. When I played this in LA, I really sucked at it, to be very honest. the good part about the game is that it's got so many layers to it, right? I mean, it's not just it's not just 5-on-1 shooter. You know, you need to really understand the heroes. You need to really like invest time in understanding what abilities can do and how they can actually come together as a group of 5 people. So it has layers that takes a lot of time to invest. I don't have that kind of time available in my hand right now. So I still set the game. But I do feel that at a global level, of course, you know, we've dominated the Counter-Strike scene for a very, very long time. We already are, you know, and obviously this is kind of confidential information, but like any other pro teams right now, we obviously already have a bunch of kids, a bunch of pro players who are basically waiting for Riot to announce something really, really big, kind of similar to League of Legends, where there could be a league in place. And I think immediately everyone will suddenly see like pro teams coming up in London from nowhere. I don't see any difference in India as well. As soon as the esports side of it gets kind of defined by the community, I'm sure that Riot would want India to be a part of the whatever the league system would look like. And does Fnatic India play a role in that? Well, I mean, say, for us, I know for a fact that Patrick's always looked at India as a very a possible market to actually pick up talent. So whether as a team we'll be able to compete at the highest level, I'm not really sure. But I'm sure that individual talent getting picked up from India is something that we are looking at. And again, you know, if there is a great player who plays Valorant from India who can represent Fnatic from the European market, why not? We definitely open to that idea.
Luciano, we've heard one of this really cool program called Ignite that you're doing. Do you want to go ahead and talk about the Ignite program?
Ignite series is an interesting one. It's a first one for Riot Games as a whole. It's an initiative that we took for several reasons. I mean, we still have a long journey before we kickstart our global esports. There's still a lot of things that we need to polish, you know, bugs and fixes here and there. Rank just got announced. You know, we need to work around the observer mode. So there's a lot of different things that we need to perfect still before we really deep dive into esports or what Riot Games is known for, you know, like within League of Legends. So Ignite series for us is, you know, some sort of a trial. That is going to be running for around 6 months. And the purpose of Ignite series is to help and support and push smaller businesses, third-party tournament organizers, to grow. The way we've positioned it is, you know, we're approaching. So at least here for the MENA region, we've approached several tournament organizers. We've shared with them our plans and how we can create some sort of a grassroots community tournament that will promote one, the communities, two, the tournament organizer himself, and three, the players. And what makes it special is that whatever we do on Ignite series, we are also promoting it and promoting the channels from our global channels. And this is something that has never happened before, specifically for our region. So yesterday we've announced Empire Play's North African Invitational.
Nice.
Yeah.
And in this ignition, and I think Sukamal, you're up obviously after this, it is there. How can we go ahead and do, and we've also seen something like this that you're doing with IO in Malaysia, with Southeast Asia, and how does that stitch together, and while this is great global, how the Indian community will always love something for India, right? So what can we do to go ahead and have those kind of conversations?
Right. And I think Luciano made a very valid point saying at what stage are we in from a market perspective to unlock at what stage, right? For example, for our first party Riot events, of course, we are still some time away because, first of all, we need to make sure that our infrastructure is set and people are having a good experience before we can do anything like self-produced. So the first stage will definitely, we have to look at how does the community, how do we unlock things for the community, right? Especially in terms of, let's say, organizers and grassroots, communities to come together and do events on their own, and we enable them, right? The idea is to make sure that we are there to support them in terms of licenses, in terms of giving them guidelines on how to do a good show around the game. Third is hey, is there a possibility for us to help them with unlocking some more potential, especially in terms of sponsors or kickstarting some of the conversations, and also in terms of how can we promote those grassroots organizers to really to shine and bring those experiences to a bigger community, right? So those are the things which we're going to be definitely focusing on, and that's the reason why I think it's very important for Akshat and team to come up and help and work with us, help us to understand how do we best unlock these things for the Indian community here. Maybe you guys can come up with a nice series of events that we can look at the community perspective, where we unlock them for the rest of the year as a calendar year, have these excitement coming up, and then really when the server announcements are done and people actually have the server where they can play it, then we can actually take it to the next level where we make it a slightly more organized format, where because we will know exactly what experience we can bring, right? And this is where I would like to leave throw the ball at you guys and say, hey, Akshat, make this happen. I mean, you have pro players here, you have people, streamers here, and you have the publisher here. When is the Valorant event coming from NODWIN?
No pressure.
Well, you always put me on the spot. You always put me on the spot, and it's a good thing, which is there. No, we are super happy to do this. I think there can never be a better community get together like this, where we have everyone on board. We are having this video and everyone's watching live. We'd like to officially commit that NODWIN will support Valorant. And within a month, we'll be announcing our tournament with you guys, where NODWIN will go ahead and front lead it. And we'd like to be part of the Ignition series. We'd like to be part of going and building Valorant. I think it's a very strong future, and we 100% support it. So you heard it here. Since you put me on the spot, Valorant tournament within 1 month. I promise.
Awesome. So you'll definitely get a team from the publisher side. So Luciano, me, and the rest of the guys from the office will team up and we'll play whoever you make us play. I mean, we'll be on stage or we can be playing from our homes, but we'll be there for the show. I mean, we've always loved what NODWIN brings to the esports scene in India. And we can't wait to be part of it, both as a publisher as well as a player. I mean, we would form our own team, man. I mean, give us a chance. Give us a shot at being India's best Valorant team. And we want to prove it that we have not just played the game from its alpha stage for nothing. We want to showcase our skill sets, man.
So, Ankit, put you and Xyaa on the spot. I want one team from you and one team from Brutality. You can just make it a community cup and you can go ahead and bring all those followers that you have. And Xyaa, why don't you also bring in a team of yours?
Yeah, definitely. I do play with my friends on a regular basis. So yeah, definitely we'll be up for it.
There you go. Ankit, you.
100%. We are already, you know, planning a team to go pro in Valorant as well. So we're working on it, and let's do this community thing. It'll be great for people to, you know that Valorant is something that they should enjoy, and they will enjoy, and they should play, because the publisher are also very excited. And when NODWIN Gaming supporting it, you know, there was nothing a few years back in esports when you talk about India, but Mr. Akshat, Mr. Gautam, NODWIN Gaming, they have grown this scene. They have helped me, they have helped all the, you know, professional teams and players, and I'm glad now getting you guys on board for this, and you guys taking so much focus on the country, on India. It makes us feel, you know, happy that we are doing the right things and we are doing esports in the correct way.
So Ankit's got a team, and Xyaa's bringing a team, and NODWIN's organizing this, and Riot's also gets a team. It won't be proper if we don't actually go ahead and send it to the one person who actually manages teams for a living, and Fnatic, it wouldn't be a great Valorant tournament if we didn't have a team, at least from a community side, from your point of view. I'm going to put the ball in your court. Would Fnatic India go ahead and field a community team?
Yes, I will get the 5 best looking players, but they will be really, really bad.
Don't make face clam. on a real note, thank you so much for that. We'd love to go ahead and do that tournament, Sukamal. I look forward to that. I promised you a month. In a month, we'll have that tournament that we're looking for to go ahead and be part of this. Let's ignite India. Let's also go ahead and do that. Let's build this love for this community here, and we'll move that forward.
This is great that we're making like announcements for like the events on the show, but we would just like the fan base to know that like there's a much more structured way of like, you know, us looking at esports, and you will definitely get to hear more about it as in the coming months once we make our servers official for the region, and then you'll definitely see a much more comprehensive plan and calendar for the whole year, in terms of which will include events, which will include activations, which will include a lot of other things that we are planning in terms of publishing for the game, right? So rest assured, stay short. We are just getting started. As part of the journey, we'd like to invite you on board the Valorant train. Like I said, this train will not stop. And be on board for a wild ride for the next 10 years.
Sukamal, we're also living in a COVID world, right? You just announced yesterday that you are going and doing, listening to the community, and you have official ranked, and Ankit's just been super happy about it. But more than that, we also live in a very responsible world right now. I think the leadership that gaming has always done and has been trying to go ahead and do for a long time, Riot's in the past learned from it, NODWIN's learned from it, Fnatic's learned from it, is diversity. That one word is not just a word that you want to throw. It actually makes us stronger physiologically, psychologically, emotionally, ethically. Everywhere, diversity makes us stronger. It's not this. What's your view on that? Nimish, what's your view on that? Xyaa, you've obviously been looking at, and you're championing the fact that women need to be more involved in gaming, and you're literally the torchbearer for us in India. Just let's talk about something like that. Sukamal, up to you first.
Yeah, awesome. I think the way that we see is that like we welcome diversity, right? So for us, we look at people who enjoy our games and our service and whatever we bring to, let's say, to the general population. So we don't like necessarily, of course, like coming from a gaming background and being playing games. So there is a tendency to like, you know, to really look at the world in very black and white, right? So the thing is like, you know, sometimes a lot of times the way we express ourselves, we are not even aware that it might not be, let's say, mindful of the fact that there is a lot of diversity out there who might not be very appreciative of the way you're expressing yourself, right? That's very important for us to acknowledge. And so now I think what it needs to do is like it should go beyond lip service, right? All of us want diversity. Nobody is like, no, nobody has an opinion which says, okay, this is how it should be. No, I mean, like if you talk to any human being, at the end of the day, we want people to be happy, right? And that's the first thing that I think we should break down in terms of the building blocks for any kind of diversity program or any kind of way we look at diversity. It should not be forced. It should be it should come across in everything that we do, be it the way we communicate with our peers, with our family members, with our friends, or be it the way that we express ourselves, be it in terms of our creativity, be it in terms of the way that we express our happiness in terms of like be it a win or be it a loss, even in our games, right? So from the perspective, I think we are very clear in what we want to achieve. We have always been player first, and that's the message that we want to make sure that is coming across in whatever we say and whatever we do, right? So whatever we, whenever we make games and whenever we make it available for market, we make sure that like we are very mindful of what is important in the culture, what is important in the market, and what are our fan base expecting out of us, and we should definitely try to live up to those expectations. So from the perspective, like I say, it goes beyond just saying the nice words of how diversity should work, but I think our games and services speak for themselves, and we definitely want to like, you know, support all our fan base. We just love our fan base. We don't really see you as, let's say, X, Y, Z. We see you as people who love to play games, and we'd love to play games with you. It doesn't matter what you are, who you are, or where you come from.
It's good that you know, I really like this question, Akshat, from your side, because we currently live in a world that is really dominated by the internet, and as you guys know, you know, the last couple of days, if you're on Twitter, for example, there've been a lot of things happening within the gaming industries. You know, a lot of things that, you know, me myself as a human being, just opening the application kind of like breaks my heart. It's become such a gloomy place to hear that all these things have been happening, and it's a very sensitive topic to talk about, especially for our region within the MENAI, you know, Middle East, North Africa, and India. You look at our region, there's so many different backgrounds and cultures. You know, what could be considered fun and amazing in Saudi Arabia could be taboo in Egypt. What is acceptable in Egypt could be you know, bad for India, and keeping that in mind makes, you know, any game developer's job a little bit hard, because you need to be sensitive across the board. I'm fortunate enough to be working at a company like Riot Games, where our diversity team, you know, with Angela, has been really, really changing the way Riot Games see things and the culture internally. And I think this is something that really comes back down to an individual level. When we are planning certain roadmaps, I'll give you an example. You know, Ignition series, since we've touched point pretty quickly on it, we've launched North African Ignition series, which is Morocco, Tunisia, and Algeria. And I got random DMs and Discord messages from unknown, saying, why is a half Argentinian, half Lebanese guy that works in Dubai running North African tournaments? The North Africa should be run by North African player. And my answer was very simple. And I said, you know, I'm a gamer. I don't see nationalities, I see players. And I think that, you know, that philosophy, that statement of, we are all gamers, you know, we're here to play games, have fun. Some it's a living, for others it's a passion. And we should go beyond that color, race, gender, nationality, and just say, you know, we're all gamers. Let's talk gaming. Let's talk players. It is a very sensitive time we live in right now. And I can assure you from our side, because, you know, within this region, Riot Games, we're such a diverse, I mean, we have everything. I think we have the United Nations in the office here. You know, we have Sukamal from India. I'm a complete salad. You know, I'm a mix. We have someone from Tunisia, someone from Syria, Turkey. And I think that mix is great, because it helps us kind of understand those different cultures, those different ways of seeing things. And when it comes to planning roadmaps, I think that we know how to communicate things to our audience. So yeah, you know, diversity is an important thing to always keep. I think if it's not the most important thing to have at top of mind.
So Xyaa, I'd love for you to go ahead and actually now take up from where Sukamal talked about. You know, I really, really would love more people to be involved in this. And we've seen people, you've been that charge. And after you've started, there have been more women. Global Esports has set up a strong division, which is there. Earlier, there was a team called Girlaxy. And I think it goes through this entire evolutionary process. But as we've become better and better and better, and in India, we've seen, even with PUBG Mobile, there are more women getting involved. And it's no longer a bad thing to be a gamer as a female gamer. How do you feel, and what would you need, and what would you recommend for bringing more diversity into this ecosystem?
Like, since I started gaming, like since I was like a part of the community, everybody used to be just like, she's gaming only for attention, she's not a real gamer. And like, even when I started streaming, there was a ton of hate. Like, if I would like die even like once in a game, people are like, oh my god, learn to play and all that. But then if a guy does the same thing, they would be like, oh, it's okay, nice try and stuff. So that thing, like, it really gets to me. Like Luciano said, like, in the end, we're all gamers. I don't want to be known as, like, a female gamer. Even when, like, somebody comments or, like, says on my stream that, oh my God, you're India's best female gamer, I'm like, can I just be a gamer? I really don't like the label female gamer. But yeah, like, we have grown a lot since then, and the community has been very welcoming. Like, it has, like, grown in the whole accepting of me as, like, a, or more like not just me, like, other female gamers as well. Like right now in PUBG Mobile, before it wasn't so, gaming wasn't really accessible to a lot of people. And like, even like when I was young, my friends used to be like, why do you game so much? Like my female friends, they were not really interested in it, because they weren't really like, Indian parents are sort of conservative when it comes to like gaming. And when a, like, people don't really take females to become, like, to play games and stuff. So, like, my female friends used to be like, why do you like gaming so much? Like, they just didn't know about what fun it can bring you. But yeah, now that PUBG Mobile has entered the scene and it's so accessible, like, if you have a phone, I'm pretty sure everybody has a phone now, so you can just download the game for free and just start playing. So I think that has brought in a lot of females as well. Like, I have a male friend who got his friend into gaming, into PUBG Mobile, and now she also knows about gaming and everything. So yeah, it's like, I've seen a lot of rise in female gamers in the country, which is really nice. But yeah, even now there are like a lot of haters and trolls who come to my stream and they're like, get a kill at least. And then I'm like, I show my, I press tab and show the scoreboard and I'm top fragging, and he's like, he doesn't know what to say anymore. So yeah, it's still time that there's still some hate left, but I'm pretty sure it's gonna go. People just need to develop the mindset that even females can be gamers. Yeah, that's all. And it'll come with time for sure, once they see more females come into the scene.
I'm going to try and put you on the spot a little bit and think about this answer, which is there. Would you prefer, currently where we are in as India with more diversity and more accessibility on gender equality that we want to go ahead and do, which would be better? An all-female team and an all-female tournament, or women to be part of multi-gender team? Like, so there's men and women playing together.
So I have always, like always, since the beginning, I've always been kind of against the whole all-female tournament, like all-female teams. I want females to play in like the male tournaments. Like sometimes, like some girls, I've seen like some articles where they say, oh, we don't feel included and we don't have female tournaments. I'm like, why do you need female tournaments? There's no restriction in a general tournament that only males can participate. Like, make a form a team with your friends, and if you think you're good enough, then you should definitely be good enough for the tournament. So yeah, I don't really want to, like, when I get approached by other females in the scene, they're like, oh, we are making a female team, I'm like, I'm not really too up for that idea. So yeah, I would like it more if like females and males, they play together. Because it depends on your skill. It doesn't depend on your gender. If you're good enough, then you can play against the males as well. So, yeah.
Nimish, I'd love for you to go ahead and have a say on diversity. I know worldwide, Fnatic's had a very strong position on it. You come from the UK and everyone's been talking very actively around it. Your view, and then Ankit, love your inputs on this too.
There is absolutely no barrier between a man and a woman. You know, if you have the right skills, like my wife plays really, really well some of the games on PS4, and I'm extremely sad at it. And she proves that she's a better driver on the road and off the road every time you play any kind of car racing game as well. So yeah, you know, and I just hope that the company, and again, there will be haters all the time, you know, there'll always be guys who, you know, who have like this really weird way of showing this macho side. They think that, oh, you know, the only way to show the macho side is to suppress a woman, you know. And I guess the other gamers, and that's the reason I would not call them female gamers and male gamers. It's the job of the other gamers to just stand by any gamers who gets bullied, you know, whether it's a male or a female. You know, if somebody's getting bullied, just stand by them as a community and make sure that these haters just have a different space.
Ankit, I think there's no one more macho on this call than having been an ex-bodybuilder and one of the most iconic faces that are there, which is there. So, Mr. Macho Man, please tell us what do you think about this? And how would you be open with some, if a girl applied to Brutality and said, I want to be Gohan, when you put her through the test and she's actually really good?
100%. I believe in, as Xyaa said, diversity. And in fact, she played with me the Red Bull CSGO Community Cup that I did, Red Bull Frag Out. And you won't believe, I knew she's a good player, but you know, people in my chat also were kind of surprised. Oh my God, there was no hate, they were not abusing, because my community is not like that. But they were surprised that, oh my God, she's good. What's her channel? What's her Instagram? I want to go and, you know, talk to her. I want to follow her. And she streams multiple games. That's when they, you know, started realizing, oh, she's a good gamer also. So we keep. After that event, I kind of thought, you know, I should do more of these events where, you know, we make mixed teams and we enjoy the game. Be it a girl or a boy, it doesn't matter. She knows how to play. She knows how to fire an AK-47. She knows how to win clutches, and she won a lot of clutches in that. I remember a nuke round where, you know, she went up and killed 3 or 4 guys, and, you know, that won us the round, and everyone was surprised. I was always cheering because I've known her since so many years. I knew she's a good Counter-Strike player. So, you know, judging people on gender, I don't think it's right, at least in gaming for sure. Because as I said, you know, physically, you don't need anything in gaming. If your reflexes are right, if your eyes are working, you know, if you can focus, if you have known the basics of the game, if you're ready to practice, if you're passionate, you can play the game.
That was absolutely cool and phenomenal. Thank you so much to all my panelists who are there. I'm super excited. This is epic. This is the stuff that dreams are made out of. You know what? Let's go ahead and take that challenge that the Riot team actually said. Sukamal, you said, let's go ahead and announce something. Let's go ahead and do that. 4th of August, let's go ahead and do an invitational between all the people who were on this. Let's get a team Xyaa. Let's get a team Ankit Panth. Let's get a team Riot. Let's get a team NODWIN. Let's get a team Fnatic. Let's even get our friends from Global Esports. Let's get all of us 6 teams invitational. Let's look for 2 more. And let's do a big tournament on the 4th of August as an invitational to get all the teams and kickstart this Valorant journey in India. And guess what? For all of you out there who are wanting to go ahead and have a journey in Valorant and be part of it, come then. We'll tell you when the open tournament for everyone in Valorant is going to be opening. And that's the time where it's going to be really big. I look forward to do this. This is NODWIN Gaming. My name is Akshat Rathee, and I'll see you soon.